Welcome to Art in the Raw. Art in the Raw is a series of conversations with creative people. And tonight, I'm excited to introduce you to Matt Cherie. Matt is an artist and craftsman located in Santa Fe, New Mexico. If this is your first time watching, I'm your host, Ann Kelly. You might be wondering who I am. In a nutshell, I'm someone that has just been in love with art and music most of my life. About 20 years ago, I moved to Santa Fe, New Mexico to further immerse myself in the art scene and to attend art school. I've now been working in the professional gallery world for about 15 years now, and I started Art in the Raw about halfway through 2020 as a way to keep people connected and inspired. If you'd like to know more about me, take a look at the description below, and there's a link to an interview or two. But in the meantime, I'm excited to introduce you to Matt. Welcome, Matt.
Thanks for having me. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah, thanks for joining. So where are you today?
This is my home office. It's, you know, where I take photos and keep a lot of my tools and also where I shove everything when I need to clean up for guests.
We all need places like that. So you describe yourself as an artist and a craftsman. I know photography's been a big part of your practice over the years.
We can go back to high school for this story. I really fell in love with photography in the 10th grade. You know, we had a traditional darkroom there on campus. I really just fell in love with it. The red light and the darkroom and the you know, just the magic of putting the blank paper in the tray and watching it turn into a photograph was so fun. And the smells and everything, it was very sensory kind of process. And so I pursued photography for years. I studied it in college and went on to run the darkrooms for the Santa Fe Photo Workshops. And this was right at the birth of digital photography, which is a very exciting thing. And, you know, at the time it was very controversial and, you know, pretty much now everything is digital. But for me personally, that's when photography turned into more of like a computer job. You know, it was just, you're just on your computer all the time. And that is not as interesting to me as the darkroom and the film. So I really struggled with that. And I really struggled like with my identity as a human being, because I had always identified as a photographer and it was something that I just like didn't enjoy doing anymore.
I could relate because I was first introduced to photography at a young age in the dark room and it's a very different experience.
Well, and yeah, and the thing is that practically the experience is sitting in front of a computer. You know, right. It's probably not that different from being like a banker or being anything. It's all, everything is just in the computer now. Working with my hands, it was something that the darkroom allowed you to work with your hands as well as your head and your heart and get into it. With the computer, it just seemed like office work.
Sure. And that's not really why you fell in love with photography.
There was so many layers to it. You think about the photo, you compose it, but then you go in there and work with your hands and make something, turn an idea into reality, bring something into existence that didn't exist before. With digital, you know, like you still create images, but there's like, it's in a way like, where are they? There's no piece of film you can hold up to the light.
And I think just the process of shooting is a little different as well.
Oh, yeah. Remember a film budget?
Yeah.
You know, like I think about that when I get a job to do an editorial portrait, which I do get from time to time. And I still love it. I love working with people. But yeah, when you had maybe three rolls of film, three times 36 to get it right, and no little preview.
You better make sure you got that right.
You know, I always make sure to get a shot of the person. You get way far away and just get a shot of them standing in the doorway or something of an interesting building, just in case, you know, because those you could always get right. They could be frowning, they could be blinking, whatever. Some people were just not comfortable in front of the camera.
I think probably a lot of people, I would say.
Maybe. Well, back then too, you know, it was like, it was a big deal because you had to bring lights. Nobody had iPhones, you know, there was no such thing as digital. So you just, it was just a big deal.
Probably people are more comfortable in front of the camera now that everybody has a phone on their camera and they're taking selfies and pictures of their friends all the time. And
it's funny you said everybody has a phone on their camera.
Yes, exactly. So maybe that's the way I see it.
No, like nobody uses the phone. It's one of the least used features on the device.
So I was doing a little research prior to this. When you were in high school, you wanted to be a pyrotechnic engineer.
Well, that was one of the options. Yeah. I mean, I was really interested in chemistry, one of my favorite subjects. I went down to New Mexico Tech in Socorro, and that was something that they did down there. And it just seemed like a cool thing.
I'm thrilled by photography.
Yeah. You know, I just decided to go that path to UNM, which has a great photography program and a great fine arts program, something that I've not regretted. It's been fun trying to live a creative lifestyle, trying to make money with creativity instead of
being a banker or
of these jobs that involves using a computer.
And you got to study with some great professors at UNM.
I really did. Patrick Nagatani just passed away, one of the greats, the New Mexico greats. Tom Barrow, Betty Hahn was one of my favorites because she was a big influence. She was one of the first people to ever buy art from me. So that was pretty neat.
Wow, that's a huge honor.
When I was studying at UNM, they had a course called non-silver, which now they call alternative process, because of course, everything is non-silver, right? So this was Van Dyke, cyanotypes. I don't think we did platinums because it was too expensive. Mm-hmm. Gum bichromates. And, you know, of course, we're fortunate enough to have Bostick and Sullivan here in town. One of the primary suppliers of all these chemicals for all these antique photo processes. When you're in college trying to graduate, you just take every class that you're interested in. And I took these non-silver classes as sort of electives, I guess, maybe they would have been called. I don't think Betty Hahn taught the class, but I knew her. She taught maybe an introduction to photo or photo two, sort of just knew her as a teacher, but in one of the big survey classes. But one of her graduate students was teaching us the non-silver stuff. You know, in a way, the technical aspect of coating papers and getting perfect exposures, I was not that great at. But making photograms was something that I loved. And you don't have to be so technically accurate because there's not a way that it's supposed to look. You know, you come out with whatever it is you come out with, and either it works or it doesn't. I invented a process called the mattograph, which was instead of creating your own shadow in the darkroom, I always say a photogram is the art of capturing a shadow. But instead of creating your own shadow, I would go out into the world with this, you know, homemade photo paper and find my own shadows to capture. And that was the difference between a traditional photogram and a mattogram. For that advanced non-silver class, we had to have a show, and we did. And it was, again, like I said, Betty Hahn's student was teaching it, and we all put pieces in the show, and Betty Hahn came and decided that she had to have my piece. And again, it was a real honor, and all the other students in the class were sort of like, oh wow, like this guy, because they were very serious about the technique, about getting everything perfect. And I remember the piece I bought, it was just two long, narrower strips, one with a hammer on this side, and then one strip with a bunch of nails on the other side, and very simple stuff we had around the house. But, you know, a little bit conceptual, and it was a cyanotype. I just cut a single mat with two windows in it. Anyways, I was very proud of that moment.
Eddie's kind of a big deal and very cool of her to inspire you in the form of purchasing a piece.
She was funny too, because she was kind of like a real low key. She's like, well, I felt like I had to buy something. And picked out one of them and it was mine. So we, it was good. I was very pleased.
My buddy Brian Taylor went to UNM. I don't know what year. Betty taught him gum bichromate.
Okay. Yeah. That was certainly UNM. Her specialty.
And then he went on to be a professor as well.
Cool.
In San Diego. So check out that episode on another.
I will. Well, I'm excited. I'm going to watch them all.
And then Patrick Nagatani, you got to study with him.
Patrick Nagatani taught us the intro to color class, which was just, I mean, it's like a pretty cool thing to have such big names teaching you that sort of thing.
Oh, definitely.
And yeah, and again, this was all pre-digital days, and this was color, so then no safe light at all in there. You put it in the box and stumble around, feed the paper into the machine, and go out the other side and watch it plop out, go back in the dark and get it right. But it was fun. You know, of course, in the case of color, rather than contrast and exposure, it's color balance and exposure. And I guess it must have been contrast you get in the paper. It's been a long time, but.
I know. I think around the same time period, roughly, I was at the College of Santa Fe. David Scheinbaum and Steve Fitch and Nancy Suter taught all of non-silver classes at that
time. In fact, I met Nancy. We were going to do a daguerreotype thing together because I had made a few of those at the Santa Fe photo workshops. And we kind of, you know, it's so hard to source all that stuff and to get the right, the plates coated just right. There was a place that coated the plates and you can't find them anymore.
So Nancy was my intro to all of that. And I remember at the time, buying all of the materials from Camera and Darkroom, which is still here in Santa Fe, but their inventory looks a lot different these days. I think I can't say I've been there recently, but last time there was like a little tiny film corner with maybe one type of paper.
I remember that, yeah, and like one envelope of D76 or something like that back there. I mean, it makes sense. It's hard to argue. The efficiency and the just, I mean, it's hard to argue for anything other than it's just, it was, I liked it more. It's the only thing I got arguing against digital.
Yeah. Well, I always say it depends what you're trying to do. You do some editorial work.
Yeah. Yeah. Like the editorial stuff you can see on my website. I did a lot of scientists for UNM. This, I think, was a dark matter guy. This guy, again, I think he was a math professor.
And I mean, that's one of the things is though they're editorial pieces, they're still shot with a very creative eye.
This person, this is some sort of gene sequencing behind her head there. She was a gene person.
A lot of the work you've made recently have been photograms that you've made using the cyanotype process, which for those who are not familiar, results in basically blue and white imagery, much like a blueprint.
I got into that when I first, during my college years, when I first was taking those non-silver classes. The reason I got back into it is I was offered a show at the Jean Cocteau. I decided to do photograms, cyanotype photograms. It was really well received. It was the best, you know, like the most successful show they ever had there. So they gave me another month. I rehung the show with all new stuff and we killed it again the following month. So that was really great. Such a natural thing for me to make those. I have so much fun.
Takes you back to that magic of the dark room and you don't know exactly what's going to happen.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you have to coat the paper yourself. You start out with watercolor paper and paint the emulsion on there. And then after you do the exposure, I wash it off in the shower. It is, it's very tactile. And there's a lot of unpredictability.
And you started selling, I don't know if it was maybe after that or around the same time, tote bags that had cyanotypes of bags.
Oh yeah.
On the bags.
The bag bags, I call them.
Bag bags.
I was just sort of looking for translucency. And again, as you know, trying to make a living as somebody selling art and selling imagery, you're just kind of always thinking of things. And I thought tote bags would be a good thing.
Did you start making the photograms of the plastic bags on paper before the bags?
Probably. I think, you know what it was? I got a great plastic bag that said, thank you, thank you, thank you. You know how they do. And happy, maybe a funny happy face or something. So I was trying to get a photogram of that. And at some point I thought, oh, you know what I need to do is put these on the tote bags. And that's been another thing people really have responded to, and they think it's very funny. You can find the tote bags at Modern General there on Cerrios, right by Vinaigrette. Yeah, you know, actually they had been buying birdhouses for a while. Start out with birdhouses there. And that's a whole different trajectory. So I don't know if you want to go there yet, but
maybe we'll go there in a minute. Is you have a whole series of basically portraits of remote controls.
You know, it's the interface between humanity and the machine world in a way. Really where it started for me was I was working as an art handler and going on the road a bunch, delivering big sculptures, driving all over the country and staying in a lot of hotels. And I wanted a photographic project to work on. I saw a lot of hotel rooms, but something they all had in common was the remote control and the bedspread. So I photographed all these remote controls on the hotel room bedspreads. What it really did in the beginning, more than anything else, was reminded me to bring my camera with me on the road, because I was going on these road trips, I wouldn't even bring the camera. It was just good to bring the big camera along with, because there were times, you know, I just would go, you know, travel 1,000 miles and not take a single picture. It seemed like a waste. The remote control on the hotel bedspread, more than anything, it made me excited to get into the hotel room, made me excited to get my remote control, get my composition, my picture. And I still do whenever I go and stay in a hotel room. So anyways, when I showed these, I printed up 24 by 36 inch prints of them.
Oh, wow.
So they were really big. You could really see all the like goop embedded in between the buttons and stuff like that. They're pretty dramatic. I think they make a good statement altogether. Like just as a group, they're a lot more interesting. And, you know, the show, I only had 12 or 15 at the time, but I have hundreds of them now.
It'd be cool to print just a giant grid of
them. These together. Definitely call for a grid, don't they?
I think so. Even if it just initially inspired you to bring your camera, that's huge, right?
Yeah, exactly. Because it wasn't like I would only take pictures of the remote controls. For years, I wanted to be a serious artist. And the thing is, I'm not a serious person. And I find it so much more comfortable to be a smartass artist, because I'm by nature kind of a smartass. And stuff like these remote controls, it's like, I don't know, there's a humor to it. You know, like Elliot Erwitt?
Mm-hmm.
He's one of the funniest photographers around. He's just one of my favorites. And people, I think, forget that it's okay to have a sense of humor in art.
I really think that art should reflect the person that made the art. Otherwise, it's just not authentic.
Yes, I worked for Glenna Goodacre for almost 20 years.
Much how you plan to be a pyrotechnic engineer, she wanted to basically do like photorealistic drawings of people, I think, for medical purposes.
Yeah, textbook illustration, zoology, and biology.
Yeah. And so that was her initial plan in going into art, but then she was able to expand and kind of move beyond that. And I assume she initially went into that because she just thought, okay, that's how I'm going to make a living.
That's true. And, you know, probably at the time where photography is kind of a utilitarian way to illustrate stuff these days, I think drawing at the time was probably similar.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I think that must have been, I mean, Glenna must have been a kid like in grade school at the time, because all she was selling paintings and portraits. I think in high school, she was pretty much dedicated to being a, you know, an artist, a professional artist, but a painter. Her sculpture teacher in high school or college maybe said, you know, oh, Glenna, you can't see in three dimensions, give it up, keep, you know, keep being a painter. which of course is very, you know, ironic now. So for decades, she really did amazing stuff at that studio. I ended up working for Glenna because the person who ran the Santa Fe Photo Workshops is married to the person who runs the Glenna Goodacre studio. Mm. And after I was sort of finished with the darkroom there at the Santa Fe Photo Workshops, I was kind of wondering what I was going to do. And she said, you know, why don't you go work for my husband over there? They're, you know, they always need help at the sculpture studio. And that was in like 2000, 2001, maybe. You know, I went out there and worked for them. I still work for them, really, if they need anything. And I learned so much about art from Glenna. She was a pro of all pros, and she had a team of pros. And, you know, it was a 9-to-5 job, and it didn't really matter if you weren't inspired or whatever. You went in there and you worked till lunch, and you got lunch, and then you came back and you worked until 5, and then, you know, and then you were done for the day. And treating art like a real job was kind of revolutionary to me. There was always stuff to do, and certainly in a sculpture studio, lots of physical labor. But then with an artist at that level, just, you know, maintaining the marketing and the press and the public relations was a full-time job. And then keeping track of where all the sculptures were in the world was another full-time job. Galleries all across the country, everything on consignment. Mm-hmm. It's a logistical thing to keep track of these things. When I worked for Glenna, that was really the first time I even learned that art handling was a job. The artist is the person in front of the scenes, and you don't see how many people are behind the scenes supporting the artist. So that was very interesting to learn that there were a lot of jobs, sort of art jobs, that weren't actually being an artist.
So I'm curious about the bird and pollinator houses. How did that originally come to be?
No, I think maybe my neighbor was tearing down something in his yard, and there was a bunch of scrap wood out there. I thought, you know, I'm going to make a birdhouse out of this. So I made one or two or three and gave them to my buddies. And eventually that led to one of these birdhouses getting into the hands of, or my friend now, but who was the manager over there at Modern General. So I made 5 or 6 of them and brought them in, and they bought them, and sort of the rest is history. I've been making them for years for them. It's just one of those things where there's no rules involved. You just collect some scrap wood, and whatever the materials kind of lead me to make, I'll put together. I just recently through Instagram picked up another gardening store in Healdsburg, California, called Mix Garden Materials. They seem to sell well out there too. And so that's been really fun. I've never made 3D art of my own. I've always been, you know, photography or printmaking, but somehow making these little birdhouses is very cathartic. It's just, mm-hmm. It's so much fun putting these things together, because there's not a right answer, but it turns out that there is. You do have, birds do prefer certain specifications. Working within certain guidelines, you can come up with pretty creative, fun little dwellings for these things. The other thing I've been making is the pollinator incubators, I call them. This provides habitat for local native bees and pollinators. You're not going to get honey out of these, but it gives the native bees a chance to lay their eggs, or I should say, gives the native bees a place to lay their eggs. Since we don't keep a lot of rotten wood and piles of old leaves laying around our gardens, this gives them a simulated rotten wood to a place for the larva to hatch, and a little habitat for these pollinators that are very important, as we all know these days.
So you have one kind of behind you. Are you able to reach that?
Yeah. This one is just pollinators. Yeah, basically it's just ends of scrap wood I found that I drill holes in. This one has some old children's blocks that I picked up somewhere. It's basically scrap wood, all found.
And how does that work with the pollinator houses? I feel like the bird houses are a little more obvious. There's a little hole the bird goes in.
Different size holes are for different types of bugs. There's over 5,000 bees native to North America. The honeybee is actually a European thing. Everybody wants to know where the honey, where you get the honey out of these things. But this is a different kind of bees. Basically, the mother just lays her egg in one of those chambers and then plugs up the hole with either chewed up leaf matter, sawdust, sand. I've seen wadded up grass, sort of long pieces of grass coiled into little balls stuffed in there, paper, you name it. Just different bugs use different things. And then at some point, that larva, the egg hatches, turns into a larva. I mean, it depends. There's different ways for all the different bugs. It's amazing. It's like science fiction, these things. But the larva eats through the leaf matter or whatever, and that gives it enough food to get out to the surface where it turns into a mature adult and flies away.
And then you're into gardening as well.
Yes.
Maybe kind of connected. Or very connected?
Yes. Gardening is a way that I express myself creatively as well. You know, there are times as an artist when you're not as productive as you'd like to be, but working in the garden is, I think, a way that you can sort of get that energy out. I've always felt that art is like a way of turning energetic ideas, turning energy into physical form. Einstein told us they're the same thing, energy and matter. Art is the physical manifestation of ideas. Working in the garden is a way to express that energy and to, you know, to create something that's beautiful. Another thing that I like about gardening is you have to think in the fourth dimension. If you're going to put in a shrub, you have to know how big these things are going to get. In 2 months, is it still going to be in the sunshine? Is this going to be shaded? So it's sort of fun to think about.
The gardening also kind of ties back to your cyanotypes. I was looking at some of your images earlier, maybe on Instagram, and it seems like some of the objects that were used in the cyanotype photograms came from the garden, and there was a certain use of different type of insects that you'd collected.
Absolutely. The garden is a huge inspiration for the subject matter in my cyanotype photograms. Flowers, leaf shapes, any sort of botanical specimens, these are all tend to be very interesting to me. Not just stuff from my garden, but other gardens from the road trips I would collect and taking walks with the dog, either here at the dog park, picking up stuff, looking for salvage material to make my birdhouses from, or botanical specimens from all over the country.
I have a lot of giant ravens that frequent my backyard. Do you have any birdhouses that would be suitable for giant ravens?
Gosh, you know, I don't know if ravens like houses. I've got some for owls and big woodpeckers that would be size appropriate, but I don't know, you know, you never hear about a raven house.
No, and they might not really even like that, but I don't know, maybe there's something they would like.
Boy, if anybody could appreciate some art, it would be a raven. They're very smart birds, you know. I've actually really always had kind of a connection to them. In fact, I could show you, my dad when we were kids, went to Alaska and got us wood carvings from some native artist up there. But anyways, he got me a raven and my brother a whale. My brother was always very interested in whales. But I was thinking about this the other day while skiing and watching the ravens surf around up there. It's just like they are smart enough to have fun with their life. You know,
oh, yeah.
They're like, They have a very strong play ethic, and I do too. And I like that about them.
Definitely. So that's another thing we have in common, is the mountain sports.
Yes.
And the Ravens are definitely up there. The Ravens are in my backyard. And I kind of wonder if they're the same Ravens sometimes.
I think about that. I always was thinking about if we could bribe Ravens to fly up there, get samples of the snow and bring them down to town, we wouldn't have to like check the webcam rely on reports from each other. We would just have a sampling of the snow from the mountain right there.
Perfect. Ravens ski report. Yeah. I think we need to maybe if you could make them some sort of awesome house that they would love, they would be inspired to go up and collect.
I absolutely will. I'm going to look into the specifications that Ravens require for housing, and I will get right on that.
Then they'll get us some snow samples, so we'll know, you know, how early we have to get up there.
Like, they'd be into it if we could just figure out how to communicate that with them. I think they would be up for the chore.
So another question I'm always curious about is what people collect. However, I might have read that you collect vintage cameras.
I collect vintage cameras and have for years. Something when you're in photo school, everybody has the old Polaroid sitting on their shelf. And at the time, we would just go to thrift stores and, you know, we found all sorts of stuff. I've got a little German Minox somewhere in the stack, an old spy camera.
Is it true that you actually have hundreds of them?
No, not anymore. I think there was a time.
At one point, you had, I think, 200, I might have read.
Yeah. I mean, right now, I'm going to estimate I'm down to about 40.
Okay.
But yeah, I just love these things. And in the film days, you know, you could take 120 film and spool it onto the 127 reels in these things, or 35 millimeter film you could spool onto 828 spools. So it was just always fun to just be experimenting in the darkroom and, you know, just playing with old cameras. And you never know, these low quality plastic lenses sometimes produce interesting results. But, you know, you find stuff over the years. That's the thing about being a collector, is that I've become more discerning over the years, where I don't buy it because it's a camera.
Is there anything else you collect non-camera?
Well, I would say plants in a way. On road trips, one thing I love to do is stop at nurseries and plant stores in other states. Oftentimes I'd be driving out with a truck load of sculptures, but driving back with an empty truck. And it was always fun to pick up things for the garden. Stuff you can find locally tends to be stuff that does well in gardens here, but with a little more attention, you can get a lot more variety than you'd find just locally. And every place has their own sort of specialty plants that kind of show up in every garden. It was always fun to stop at nurseries and see what they have that we can't get locally.
Do you have a favorite plant that you might have picked up on the road?
I love the citrus plants. I brought back a lot of citrus from Florida, and I've killed a lot of citrus plants from Florida. People say, gosh, you probably never kill any plants, you're such a good gardener. But the secret is, like, you know, you just have to kill enough plants to where you have enough that have survived.
Right.
That you, it looks like you have a full garden. It's a real kind of a war of attrition.
Of all of the places you've traveled to for work or other reasons, is there a favorite or a favorite place that you maybe can't wait to go back to?
No, you know, it's funny. So much of my traveling was just on the highway. There was just a lot of driving, which I enjoy. You know, I love listening to books on tape. We would go to all these great sort of vacation venues off season, because we would want to get all the good art there in time for their big tourist season. So, like, I've been to Nantucket in the wintertime, and you know, Florida during hurricane season. And I enjoy being in motion and traveling on the road, in a way, it doesn't even matter what the destination is.
Right. It's, just the act of traveling.
Yeah. Yeah. Just being mobile is fun. Much like working on a computer is kind of like what the reality of so many jobs are these days. Like, I bet being a spy, being a novelist, being a photographer, it's probably all like just sitting at a computer. You know, traveling and staying in a fancy hotel is a lot like, you know, staying in a fancy hotel in Rome is pretty similar to staying at a not so fancy hotel in Tucumcari. There's like a bathroom and a bed and a shower and a TV and a remote control.
I was gonna say, don't forget the remote control.
Yeah, right. And so like in a real basic practical sense, it's not that different. So I don't know, but I do enjoy being on the road and on a road trip with a good book or a good song and a constantly changing view. And it's a good space for me.
And you've done a few artist fairs. What was that like for you?
Oh, that's fun. Working in the arts over the past decades now, you get so comfortable with your spiel. There was a time when I was first, you know, fresh out of art school and really took that stuff very seriously. But you know, you do enough of those shows to where you get very comfortable talking about the work, and you become more comfortable being honest about it, you know, where you don't have to have anything high and mighty to say about the work. You know, it's like, it's okay to just acknowledge that you were curious what this was going to look like. You know, you just wanted to do something. It is hard doing those fairs because you do invest a certain amount of money for the fees. Maybe you got some cards printed and, you know, you got to get yourself there, and maybe you got to get a hotel room if it's far enough away. So, you know, there's economically, you hope that it makes sense. And, you know, usually I'll make a little bit more money than breaking even. Mm-hmm. So it's always worth the time. And again, you bring a stack of cards and you always get a few calls afterwards, and you always sell a few prints after the fact. And in a way, those are the best, because people will call and say, gosh, I've been thinking about that one picture. Do you still have that print left? I wish I got it at the time. And connections lead to sales, and it never hurts to go to those things and get your name out there.
So going back to travel, here's a fun question, I think. If you could time travel, past or future?
Gosh, I don't know. This is a pretty good time to be alive right now. Mm-hmm. It's a good time to be like a beer drinker. It's a good time to be a skier, although hopefully we still have snow. But my God, the technology and the equipment is so fun these days. There's a lot of good things about right now, I think. And, you know, another thing is, I always say I've been 40 years my whole life. Even when I was a kid, I was a 40-year-old. And now that I am 40, things seem to make sense right now.
You're finally the age you always were.
So I think so.
Maybe you're time traveling right now.
Maybe. And, you know, I'm very comfortable in the pandemic. I'm like always socially isolated. I'm always a little bit underemployed. I feel very comfortable right now.
It seems to be a good time for artists just working on what they want to work on. There's got to be somewhere. I mean, maybe you want to go to, I would go to Paris in the 20s and have a drink with Man Ray.
Oh yeah, that'd be cool. I'll bet that guy's a character.
I think some, that would be fun. Yeah.
Yeah, right. You could probably get the real absinthe back then too. You know, I think New York in the 70s, if one didn't get murdered, could be sort of cool. Some great photography, some great art. And you know, at the time, I think much like Man Ray did showing up in Paris, I think you could just show up and say, I'm a famous photographer. And I think as long as you had a something in your portfolio. They couldn't really Wikipedia you or whatever and be like, no, you're not. This Wikipedia doesn't have your name on there. How can you be famous? Like, I think you could just show up, say you are what you are, go down, you'd see the Ramones at CBGB's. I think that that could be a pretty interesting time. But, you know, it's funny, all that stuff gets compressed, you know, to where it's sort of like, you think of maybe a decade as just happening over a few weeks or something. I don't know. But again, I do think this is a pretty interesting time. I think this is a good time to be alive.
Oh, definitely. And it's the only time. I mean, it's now. So what's better than the present?
We're coping with the internet and what it means, and sort of like the abundance of information, I think is difficult for us to know exactly what to deal with. But I'm excited. Oh, how about this? How about time traveling to a time where we're like not freaked out by you know, the constant bombardment of technology, and maybe some interstellar travel, interplanetary travel. I think that stuff is pretty interesting. I love science fiction. All right, yeah. I've thought of the answer.
You're going with that?
I would time travel, I think, to the future and see some space travel stuff. God, I love that stuff. You know, when NASA, all the footage, the new footage of Mars and stuff, it's all very cool, I think.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And they released all that video footage recently with sound and everything.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I thought maybe that sound was added in there.
I'm not an expert, but
no, I don't either. I'm not either, but how cool. I gotta double check on that.
If you could travel to any planet in the known universe.
Yes.
Like Elon Musk was just like, hey, do you wanna go somewhere?
There's a lot of very interesting moons of, gosh, now I feel like I should check my facts, but moons of Saturn and moons of Jupiter. You've got your Io and your Europa. You know, one of them is made out of water. You've got liquid water there, mm-hmm. icy crust, liquid center water core. I think they think that's where the life might be, you know, the squid monsters, or who knows, speculation. But yeah, I think some of the moons of Saturn and Jupiter, rings of Saturn, I think that would be quite a sight. But the amazing thing is, it's, you know, there is footage of that stuff, like real footage, not generated by a computer, that we can see, that's funded by the public and publicly available, and fascinating stuff.
But no, yeah, you're right. I mean, we're in some very interesting times that those types of things are being explored.
Yeah. Well, you know, also speaking of living in great times, binge-worthy TV, my goodness. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of pretty wonderful TV these days.
That is true. And that's one of my other favorite questions. Favorite movies or favorite shows that are on Netflix right now?
Yes. Yeah. Well, I was going to say, remember when we were kids, there were three channels. And then if the president was on, forget about it. You weren't watching anything. I just rewatched Trading Places, which is one of my all-time favorites. Old John Landis movie, mm-hmm. Eddie Murphy, Dan Aykroyd.
Yes.
Oh, I remember. They've just made Coming to America too.
Yes. Is that out? I heard it was coming out.
I think it's out. I think it's it is, and I think Prime produced it and made it. So I'm excited to see that. But because Coming to America, one of my favorites. That whole era of Eddie Murphy, Dan Aykroyd, John Belushi. I love all those movies. Blues Brothers.
How can you go wrong with any of those actors?
Trading Places, Golden Child. And this was, I mean, I was sort of growing up at the time, and this was pretty formative stuff for my sense of humor and my mm-hmm. my ideas of what greatness is. So, but God, the Blues Brothers, what a soundtrack too.
So how about music? When you're editing photos or making bird or pollinator houses? Do you listen to music?
You know, I listen to podcasts mostly. I do listen to music. And again, this comes back to this whole question of identity. There was some time where I thought it was just like punk rock. I just wanted to listen to punk rock and like hip hop and just the harder the better. But now I listen to everything and just, I say, if it's good, I'll listen to it if it's song. So like, I love Patsy Cline, for example, just such a departure from all that stuff. But there's some, there's just wonderful stuff. And if you don't limit yourself to sort of a genre first attitude, you really can expose yourself to a lot better stuff. Or, I mean, just, I don't know, there's just such a world of great music.
No, I hear you. If you're not like, not, I only listen to blah, blah, blah.
Yeah. Then, yeah. Or, I mean, when we were kids, it was like, I never listened to country. You know, it's, but like, gosh, there's great stuff. Buck Owens and all that old stuff too. I love it. He was an old country guy.
So I must admit, I am a huge fan of punk rock and hip hop. So I'm curious if you have a favorite punk rock and hip hop album.
Well, the Ramones are gotta be my favorite band. You know, Rocket to Russia is a pretty phenomenal album. And then De La Soul, 3 Feet High and Rising.
Yes.
Another, like, I mean, just such a such a classic. If I was forced to pick, it would probably be those.
I know, it's hard to pick, but those are great choices.
What about, what's your favorite punk rock album?
Oh, yeah. So yeah, that's bad. I asked you and then I'm like, oh, that's so hard. But I guess just favorite punk rock bands ever are probably gonna be like Dead Kennedys, Crass, Misfits.
Oh yeah, the Misfits.
So many good ones.
I can appreciate like a lot of like Minor Threat, for example. So hard and just like so aggressive and really hardcore, but like there was still, there's melody in there, which I can appreciate now. I think now a lot of that stuff, if I haven't already heard it, I probably wouldn't go looking for some new hardcore like thrash punk, because I've already had plenty of that in my life. But like having heard all that stuff before, I really like it's great.
That is always kind of a question. Is it because you grew up with something that you love it as much as you did?
In this case, yes, with Minor Threat for sure.
Yeah. No, I had a Minor Threat poster in my bedroom when I was in high school. The guy with his head down and it was red and black and
sure. Yeah, yeah.
Which you know the one. I forget which album that was, but it was pretty iconic.
I know the photo for sure. Well, that was the day too, in those film days when like there was iconic photos. You know, now there's so many images of everybody, but like the cover of London Calling with Paul smashing his bass, you know, it's just like such an iconic image. Mm-hmm. Now if that happened, there'd be video of it, you'd see the same act from 20 different angles, and it wouldn't, like, it's not as memorable, but like that still image, you know, I can call it up in my head, I can remember it.
Right, we're kind of bombarded in this so day much. And age. I don't,
or like, yeah. Like the Hindenburg crashing, everybody knows that one image.
Right.
Because there weren't 1,000 images, video, and still of that event.
Right, on yeah. 19 different platforms.
Yeah, right, exactly. So, you know, when I was a kid, my dad had records of Sherlock Holmes and The Shadow and the Bickersons and all these sort of old-timey radio programs, and I love listening to that stuff. So I really have always had a taste for audio, audio drama and audio performance. And again, when you get on road trips, this was also the time of books on, like, literal books on tape, where you'd have to take out the tape, flip it over, and you know, you'd have 20 tapes for a long book. I don't know, I've always really loved having people tell me stories and or tell me interesting facts. And yeah, in this day and age, there's so many choices. It's really, it's pretty great.
I'm all about the stories. So before I let you go, you live in Santa Fe, New Mexico, and we are the home of green and red chili, red or green, in terms of your favorite and where?
This is a very controversial question, but having been born here all my life,
mm-hmm. as we say,
I feel that mine is totally entree based. Mm. For example, if I'm getting a cheeseburger, it's green chili. Like, I don't do a red chili cheeseburger, but I like red on enchiladas, for example. Mm-hmm. So it just sort of depends. La Choza is great for both red and green.
Yeah, my favorites.
Yeah, well, and right here in the neighborhood. Tomasitas is another one that's been around forever. Great chili there as well. Except for that cheeseburger, I tend to go green with chicken, red with beef.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of my standard. But again, it's entree based, and it's also place driven.
No, it definitely is. There's some places are my green places and some are my red.
Right. I'm not going to just say, I mean, I guess some people are hands down red or green, but mm-hmm. it's, you know.
Or Christmas.
Yeah. Well, that's in fact a pretty good option almost always.
Best of both worlds. And Christmas, for anybody who's watching that does not live here, that's when you get half red, half green. Best of both worlds.
You can do it any time of the year.
Do you have any chilies going in your garden?
No, you know, I don't. I don't do the chilies. My garden is pretty shady. And I try to grow stuff that is perennial and more productive. So I've got like a bunch of kales in there. And I've got a bunch of chards growing, and they're just starting to come back, in fact, for the year. Like, I'll do one tomato bush. Sometimes I'll do peppers, but for the most part, it's just leafy greens. Oh, and strawberries, a ton of strawberries.
Oh, yeah.
They don't seem to really produce any fruit, but they just spread like crazy. So we'll see.
And they look pretty.
Yes. And grapes. I've been putting in grapevines. Mm. And those are fun. I put them out on the sidewalk for the whole neighborhood. That's a nice way to share the garden with everybody. And people love them. And the birds love them. And the raccoons love them too, which is, but anyways.
Maybe better sometimes than others.
God, those guys don't care either. You go out there, you yell at them, and they yell right back. The raccoons do not care at all.
Well, great talking to you. Do you have any plugs, shout outs, anything like that?
I would like to thank Modern General at 637 Cerrillos Road here in Santa Fe, New Mexico. They've been selling my bird houses for years, but you can also get my cyanotypes there. The cyanotype tote bags that we were talking about. They also have greeting cards and mixed garden materials. In Healdsburg, California. That's 1531 Healdsburg Avenue. And they have been selling my birdhouses too for a couple of months. And I'm really excited to be working with them. I would also like to plug my Instagram at Matt Surrey, my at For the Birds and Bees Instagram, where you can see my birdhouses and bee houses, and at The Poodle Charles.
Gotta get Charles up there for sure.
I suppose so.
Well, it was great talking to you, and I hope to see you on the ski hill.
It was great talking to you too. Thanks so much.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for joining, and have a great night. Thank you for watching Art in the Raw. If you enjoyed the conversation, which I hope you did, please like, comment, and subscribe. Keep the inspiration going. Have a good night.